Look at this tiny little forest.
Yeah, Matt, that's one of those little cryptic groups that's actually related to the sea anemones and the corals and the jellyfish. They're called hydroids or sea ferns. The normal way in which they grow is that they send out a pipe that they grow inside. The pipe's made out of chitin, the same stuff that insect exoskeletons are made out of. So this pipe goes along the surface of the seaweed or of the rock, and then the animal's body goes along inside that, and then periodically it sends up an upright, like a tree, upright growth with branches to the side, a bit like a fern leaf or a bit like a feather. And from those side branches emerge little tiny polyps, like little sea anemones. And that's actually one of two life stages that this animal has. So rather like a moth and its caterpillar or butterfly and its caterpillar, this animal has two life history stages. So it has this polyp stage that looks like a fern, and then those polyps actually bud off tiny little jellyfish.
What? They go like swimming away.
And those jellyfish go swimming away. And the jellyfish is the sexual stage. So the jellyfish are male and female, and they produce sperm and eggs, which merge together and make a little larva. And that larva grows back into the fern-like thing.
Amazing.
So it's a completely mixed life cycle. Whereas in jellyfish, for example, the medusa stage has become dominant. Whereas in sea anemones, the polyp stage has become dominant.
Yeah.
In hydroids, we've got half, half and half. They're best of both worlds.
They must be incredibly small when they're these little baby jellyfish.
So these little baby jellyfish, yeah, they're maybe a few millimeters across. So we don't often see them. If you were to take a plankton sample in the open sea, you would find lots of them. But poking around on the seashore here, they're so small and so transparent that one hardly ever sees them. So the dominant stage that is described in all the books is the polyp stage, the branching stage.
Looks like a plant, too.
Yeah, yeah. They look quite like plants, and they're easily confused with either seaweeds or some bryozoans actually look quite similar. So all of these animals are filter feeders. They have a crown of tentacles, and then they open up, put out their tentacles, and then grab little particles from the water with their stinging cells and eat them. And then that food is shared between all the individuals in the colony because they're all joined to one another. They're all one genetically identical individual with many heads. In fact, that's where the term comes from. You know, about Greek mythology, there's Hydra.
Yeah.
It was a creature that when you cut off its head, it grew two new ones.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
These are called Hydroids because they're many-headed.
Mythical creatures, tiny, mythical tiny creatures, mythical yeah. creatures.
So that's the basic life form. The most usual ones that you see are these branching fern-like individuals. But you do get ones which send up just a single stalk with like a flower at the top. It appears a little bit like a little tiny daisy flower. And many of those emerge from soft things like sponges. There is one though that's only been found in False Bay that grows enormous. So the stalk is actually 25 centimeters long, and then the crown at the top is kind of this big and about the size of a proper Namaqualan daisy. And it actually bears the same name as a European species that only grows like 1 or 2 centimeters tall. So I'm quite sure it's not that species, and it needs to be re-described. But that's one of the many projects that are sitting in the queue. We don't have a hydroid specialist in South Africa to actually do that work. So that's one exceptional one. Another interesting one is a really weird thing called the gnome's hat. And that's a hydroid which has a long trunk-like body, and then the polyps, the stinging polyps, are all on the outside of that, so it's coated with little stinging polyps. And at the end of the elephant's trunk is a big mouth. And this thing sort of wafts around in the current, and when it bumps into a food item, it stings it and paralyzes it, and then the mouth turns around and ingests it. And sometimes you can actually see like a little amphipod inside the thing, jiggling around while the digestive enzymes are slowly dissolving it away. Evil thing. And one of the really interesting things about that animal, which is honestly one of the most bizarre things that I've ever seen, is that not only does the feeding part of the animal have this really weird shape, but the reproductive polyps look like little Christmas baubles that are arranged around the base of this tree, and they're striped and connected together with little strings, so it really does look like sort of a decorated Christmas tree. So we have just the name for it. Somebody has described it and given it a name, but nothing's been done on its biology, and we really don't know what these things do.
That's really weird.
Yet another interesting project. And then thirdly, there's one which lives only on the shells of whelks. If you've watched our bryozoan episode, you might recall that I also mentioned a bryozoan that only lives on the surfaces of a single species of whelk. So this is a fantastic example of convergent evolution, where two animals from completely different backgrounds are both thought of the same idea and are both moved onto the surfaces of whelks.
It's clearly an idea that works.
It's an idea that works, yeah. And in fact, there are several species on several different whelks if you look around the whole country. So both species benefit from this. The whelk benefits because it gets protection from the stinging cells of the hydroid, and the hydroid benefits because it has a little mobile home, and if, for example, the area gets sedimented, then the whelk will get up and move around. So it's got its little holiday home there, its little mobile home.
Off on adventures.
It takes it off on adventures, yeah, that's right. And then finally, there's perhaps the most unhydroid looking hydroid, is there is one hydroid that's actually called the noble coral. And it usually actually appears in guidebooks in the coral section rather than in the hydroid section. But it makes a calcium carbonate skeleton, a pink skeleton, and then the little hydroid polyps emerge from that. But unlike true corals, it doesn't have photosynthetic algae in it. So it doesn't live in the lit zone of the ocean. It lives under overhangs and in underwater caves, which where the light is very dim. And it feeds carnivorously by catching things from the water.
So with all these like weird and bizarre exceptions, how do we know a hydroid is a hydroid?
Yeah, it's not all that easy. The typical organisms are fairly easy to recognize because they have this coating, this tube that they live in, and then the polyps emerge from the tube on some sort of branching structure. And you know, most hydroids are like that. And that's fairly easy to recognize. But for these other bizarre species, we're looking at things like the structure of the tentacles and of the body, and most importantly, this alternating life cycle, so that the animal spends part of its life as a polyp or as a colony of polyps, but then it actually buds off medusae that swim away and then make sperm and eggs and turn back into polyps again.
It's kind of like a tree making seeds, except the seeds are birds which fly off and
I mean, it's amazing. Place. There's no end to the adaptations.
Yeah.
So this is just another one of those examples where, you know, if you start looking at these smaller groups of animals, then you find all sorts of really amazing adaptations and very beautiful animals, actually.
If you enjoyed watching Explore the Shore, please hit subscribe and follow our Instagram for more.